Good evening and welcome to St. Thomas the Apostle Catholic Church. Here are the announcements for this week. Each Friday during Lent, St. Thomas is hosting a fish fry at 5:30 p.m., followed by a reflection on Christ's Passion and the Stations of the Cross at 7 p.m. This coming Friday, our guest speaker will be Father Eric Gami. All are invited to come join us for this special time of community and prayer. Our parish penance service is scheduled for Thursday, March the 30th at 6 p.m. If you would like to sing with the choir for this Holy Week liturgies, please come to the practice on Tuesday evening at 7 p.m. here in the church. Thank you.
Thank you, Alan. Good evening, everybody. I made a command decision today, and our pastor does not know about this yet, so we're going to experiment first before I talk to him about it tonight. We have had problems getting or recruiting enough Eucharistic ministers for this Mass in order to add the third cup for this side of the seating area, and many of those folks are having difficulty getting to the cup that's all the way out here. So for tonight, I've asked Brenda not to do the body over here. She's going to do be my third cup. We're going to do what we used to do before COVID. Father will be in the middle, and I'll come over here first and take care of this side. Brenda will be over here where we used to be, and then she's going to follow me over, and then we'll do this side, and she will be over here so that the folks on this side will have access to the cup. It's an experiment. I don't know if it'll work. We're going to give it a shot and see. All right, thank you. Thank you.
Good evening. Welcome to St. Thomas. Tonight we're celebrating the liturgy for the third Sunday in Lent. If you would, take a moment and check any of those electronic devices that you carry and put that on silent or do not disturb. The readings tonight can be found in the green hymnal at number 889. That's the very top number on the book, on the board. Our celebrant tonight is Father Cook. He's being assisted by Deacon David. Let's stand and sing our gathering song, number 646, Be Thou My Vision, and we will sing verse 1, 2, and 4. Verse 1, 2, and 4.
Once again, with faith, hope, and joy, we gather as God's people at God's own invitation to celebrate his love for us in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of the Father, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And
my brothers and sisters, before we go any further, let us acknowledge our sins. I confess to Almighty God and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have sinned in my thoughts and in my words, and what I have done, what I have failed to do, through my most grievous fault. Therefore, our best Mary ever Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God.
Kyrie eleison,
Kyrie
eleison, Christe eleison,
Christe eleison,
Kyrie eleison,
Kyrie eleison.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. Let us pray. O God, author of every mercy and of all goodness, who in fasting, prayer, and almsgiving have shown us a remedy for our sins, look graciously on this confession of our lowliness, so that we who are bowed down by our conscience may always be lifted up by your mercy. We ask all this through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit as God, now and forever.
Amen.
A reading from the book of Exodus. In those days, in their thirst for water, the people grumbled against Moses, saying, "Why did you ever make us leave Egypt? Was it just to have us die here of thirst with our children and our livestock?" So Moses cried out to the Lord, "What shall I do with this people? A little more and they will stone me." The Lord answered Moses, "Go over there in front of the people, along with some of the elders of Israel, holding in your hand as you go the staff with which you struck the river. I will be standing there in front of you on the rock in Horeb. Strike the rock, and water will flow from it for the people to drink." This Moses did in the presence of the elders of Israel. The place was called Massah and Meribah because the Israelites quarreled there and tested the Lord, saying, "Is the Lord in our midst or not?" The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Romans. Brothers and sisters, since we have been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have gained access by faith to his grace in which we stand, and we boast in hope of the glory of God. And hope does not disappoint, because the love of God has been poured out into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us. For Christ, while we were still helpless, died at the appointed time for the ungodly. Indeed, only with difficulty does one die for a just person, though perhaps for a good person, one might even find courage to die. But God proves his love for us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. The word of the Lord.
Be with you.
And with
a reading of the Holy Gospel according to John.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus came to a town of Samaria called Sherer, near the plot of land that Jacob had given to his son Joseph. Jacob's well was there. Jesus, tired from his journey, sat down there at the well. It was about noon. A woman of Samaria came to draw water. Jesus said to her, "Give me a drink." His disciples had gone into town to buy food. The Samaritan woman said to him, "How can you, a Jew, ask me, a Samaritan woman, for a drink? For Jews use nothing in common with Samaritans." Jesus answered and said to her, "If you knew the gift of God and who is saying to you, 'Give me a drink,' you would have asked him, and he would have given you living water." The woman said to him, "Sir, you do not even have a bucket, and the cistern is deep. Where then can you get this living water? Are you great? Are you greater than our father Jacob, who gave us this cistern and drank from it himself with his children and his flocks?" Jesus answered and said to her, "Everyone who drinks this water will be thirsty again, but whoever drinks the water I shall give will never thirst. The water I shall give will become in him a spring of water welling up to eternal life." The woman said to him, "Sir, give me this water so that I may not be thirsty or have to keep coming here to draw water." Jesus said to her, "Go call your husband and come back." The woman answered and said to him, "I do not have a husband." Jesus answered her, "You are right in saying, 'I do not have a husband,' for you have had five husbands, and the one you have now is not your husband. What you have said is true." The woman said to him, "Sir, I can see that you are a prophet. Our ancestors worshipped on this mountain, but you people say that the place to worship is in Jerusalem. Jesus said to her, "Believe me, woman, the hour is coming when you will worship the Father, neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem. You people worship what you do not understand. We worship what we understand, because salvation is from the Jews. But the hour is coming and is now here, when true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and truth. And indeed, the Father seeks such people to worship him. God is spirit, and those who worship him must worship in spirit and truth." The woman said to him, "I know that the Messiah is coming, the one called the Christ. When he comes, he will tell us everything." And Jesus said to her, "I am he, the one speaking with you." At that moment, his disciples returned and were amazed that he was talking with a woman. But still no one said, "What are you looking for?" or "Why are you talking with her?" The woman left her water jar and went into town and said to the people, "Come, see a man who told me everything I have done. Could he possibly be the Christ?" They went out of the town and came to him. Meanwhile, the disciples urged him, "Rabbi, eat." But he said to them, "I have food to eat of which you do not know." So the disciples said to one another, "Could someone have brought him something to eat?" Jesus said to them, "My food is to do the will of the one who sent me and to finish his work. Do you not say, 'In 4 months the harvest will be here'? I tell you, look up and see the fields ripe for the harvest. The reaper is already receiving payment and gathering crops for eternal life, so that the sower and reaper can rejoice together. For here the saying is verified that one sows and another reaps. I sent you to reap what you have not worked for. Others have done the work, and you are sharing the fruits of their work." Many of the Samaritans of that town began to believe in him because of the word of the woman who testified, "He told me everything I have done." When the Samaritans came to him, they invited him to stay with them, and he stayed there 2 days. Many more began to believe in him because of his word, and they said to the woman, "We no longer believe because of your word, for we have heard for ourselves, and we know that this is truly the Savior of the world. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
That was a long gospel. Guess that means I have to preach a long homily. When I was born, there was no country of Israel. It wasn't until 1948 that Israel, today's Israel, declared its independence. Before then, for you youngsters that don't remember, or you people that don't have a stamp collection, the area that we refer to as the Holy Land was mostly what's called Palestine, the country of Palestine. It was after World War II, after the Allies had defeated the Germans and the other Axis powers, that the Allies, principally the British, divvied up the Near East, drew clear boundaries between what hadn't been clear boundaries before. And thus we got clear, distinct countries of Lebanon and Syria and Israel and other countries and emirates in the Near East. It's always important when listening to the scriptures or reading them, to put them in context, in their literary context, whether it's a poem or history or sacred mythology or some other, a sermon, and also their historical context. Because the same words may mean a different thing in a different time. Just like there was no Israel in 1946. Also, in 1946, if you told somebody to cool it, you would tell them to put it on ice. It means something different now. So what's going on in today's gospel? We refer to this story generally as Jesus and the woman at the well, right? What well? Jacob's well. Okay. Where? In Samaria. Okay. Countries had been realigned. There was a time when the Jews lived primarily in the country of Judah. Eventually, sons of Solomon, stage of civil war, and the country fractured into two countries, Israel in the north, Judah in the south. Centuries later, by the time the Romans came in, you had the province of Judea, the area of called the Galilee. And you had Samaria. And other territories. And as we see in today's gospel, Jesus, it's a very interesting interchange. The very fact that Jesus speaks to this lady in public, even though it was just the two of them at the time, would have been unheard of for an Orthodox Jewish man to enter into conversation with a Samaritan woman. Right? As the lady points out, you know, they're at Jacob's well. So Samaritans and Orthodox Jews had common ancestor in faith. Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and Joseph, the patriarchs. So they both worship the same God of Abraham, the God of Moses. But they had separated, not only geographically, but to some extent there was more intermarriage in the northern kingdom, what then had become Samaria. And so it was seen by the Orthodox Jews as an impure variation of religion. So anyway, the lady's taken aback that this Orthodox Jew is talking to her in public. But Jesus says, he's thirsty. Give me a drink. And she takes him to task. You know, how can you, this snobby, uppity Jew, have the nerve to ask me for a drink? And Jesus says, well, if you know who was asking, you would be asking me for living water so that you would never be thirsty again. She says, wow, I'd like that kind of water. Give me some. So Jesus says, well, go get your husband and come back. We'll see what we can do. And she says, I don't have a husband. And Jesus says, you're right. You've tried that five times and failed. And the guy you're living with now is not your husband either. You need something else in your life, lady. It's not working. And you mentioned this divide between us where we worship in Jerusalem and think that's the place to do it. Well, the Samaritans had Shechem and Shiloh, and had even built their own temple eventually, but nothing like what was in Jerusalem. And so she's kind of, well, where do you get off saying all this kind of stuff? And he says, well, you talk about the differences between us in terms of religious practices. Let me tell you, the day is coming, and in fact is already here, when it doesn't matter where you worship or specifically how. As long as you worship God in truth and with authenticity. Well, she said, well, the day is coming. Yeah, I believe in a Messiah, maybe one day, the Christ. And Jesus said, I am he. Go get your husband. No, she doesn't wait for that. The apostles come back and see Jesus talking to this lady. Anyway, they're wondering what's going on. Meanwhile, she buggers on back to town to spread the news. And sure enough, a bunch of folks come out. And they stay there a few days. What John is giving us in this gospel today might not be an exact blow-by-blow account of exactly what happened, every word and place, but he's giving us an example of a person who is open to what God might have to say. So even though this guy that she's never seen before has the audacity to speak to her in public, she answers him, And in their exchange, she sees true wisdom. And as it goes on, and he tells her that if she is really open to the word and everything, life can be really different, so much better and fulfilling. She says, well, I'll see that day. That day will happen, when the Messiah comes. And Jesus says, I am he. By this time, she has been open to something different. She's been open to words of truth. She has been open and listening to the good news of the gospel, to God's word living and present to her. And she goes beyond that and spreads the gospel, spreads her newfound faith. Come on, folks. Anybody who's interested in really good news is right outside at the well. So she goes from being kind of messed up with a life that's a mess by herself at the well, coming with others to a greater knowledge and relationship with God. Again, not just believing that God exists, but being open to God's word, accepting it and responding to it. That's the challenge for all of us. Please stand as we profess our faith together. Praying the Apostles' Creed during Lent. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From there, he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. My brothers and sisters, the Lord provides streams of living water to quench our thirst and to renew us in spirit. We draw deeply from this wellspring of life as we pray for the needs of our community and those of the whole world.
Our prayer response is, Lord, hear our prayer.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For Pope Francis, Bishop Rekha, bishops, priests, and deacons, that they may speak the word of God with joyful perseverance, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our local cities, state, and nation, that all may seek to share the wellsprings of our land with the poor and struggling countries of the world, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all divorced and separated couples and those experiencing difficult times in their marriage, that they may realize the presence of Christ in their midst, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our St. Thomas Parish faith community, that this Lenten season may be a time of reconciliation within our families and our church and parish, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who live under the shadow of death and war, especially those living in Ukraine, that they may experience light, peace, and freedom, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all those in our parish book of intentions, the sick, the homebound, the incarcerated, all members of St. Thomas, and the men and women of the armed forces and their families, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the souls in purgatory, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all our beloved dead, that they may share in the glory of Jesus' resurrection, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer. Heavenly Father, we come before you with open minds and humble hearts. Give us the vision to seek you in all things, so that our lives may be made complete in your joy and made whole in your compassionate love through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
As we bring our gifts forward, we'll sing number 678, O God, You Search Me, number 678.
Thank you.
my sisters and brothers, pray that our sacrifice may be acceptable to God, our Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of your name, for our good and of all his holy church.
O Lord, be pleased with these sacrificial offerings, and grant that we who beseech pardon for our own sins may take care to forgive our neighbors through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere, to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and eternal God, for you have given your children a sacred time for the renewing and purifying of their hearts, so that freed from disordered affections, they may so deal with the things of this passing world as to hold rather to the things that last forever. And so, together with all the hosts of heaven, we praise you, as without end, we acclaim. You are indeed holy, O Lord, and from the world's beginning are ceaselessly at work so that the human race may become holy, just as you yourself are holy. Look, we pray, upon your people's offerings and pour out upon them the power of your Spirit, that they may become the body and blood of your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, in whom we too are your sons and daughters. Indeed, though we once were lost and could not approach you, you loved us with the greatest of loves. For your Son, who alone is truly just, handed himself over to death and did not disdain to be nailed for our sake to the wood of the cross. But before his arms were outstretched between heaven and earth to become the lasting sign of your covenant, he desired to celebrate the Passover with his disciples. As he ate with them, he took bread. And giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, knowing that he was about to reconcile all things in himself through his blood to be shed upon the cross, he took the chalice filled with the fruit of the vine, and once more giving you thanks, handed the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins." Do this in memory of me.
The mystery of faith.
as we celebrate the memorial of your Son, Jesus Christ, who is our Passover and our surest peace. We celebrate his death and resurrection from the dead. And looking forward to his blessed coming, we offer you, who are our faithful and merciful God, this sacrificial victim who reconciles to you the human race. Look kindly, most compassionate Father, upon those whom you unite to yourself by the sacrifice of your Son. And grant that by the power of the Holy Spirit, as they partake of this one bread and one chalice, they may be gathered into one body in Christ, who heals every division. Be pleased to keep us always in communion of mind and heart, together with Francis, our Pope, and Stephen, our Bishop. Help us to work together for the coming of your kingdom, until that hour when we stand before you, saints among the saints in the halls of heaven, together with the Blessed Virgin Mary, the Mother of God, Joseph, her husband, the blessed apostles and all the saints, together with our deceased brothers and sisters, whom we now humbly commend to your mercy. Then, freed at last from the wound of corruption and made fully into a new creation, we shall sing to you with gladness the thanksgiving of Christ, who lives for all eternity. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, now and forever.
Amen.
Together, let us pray as the Lord himself taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant us peace and unity in accordance with your will. You who live and reign, now and forever.
Amen.
May the peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit. Let us offer each other a sign of peace. Please be with you.
This is Jesus Christ, the Lamb of God, who takes away the sins of the world. Happy are we who have been called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I'm not worthy of you. Come under my roof. Don't only say the word, not so.
Our communion song will be number 797, Come to Me and Drink, number 797.
Thank you.
Let us pray. As we receive the pledge of things yet hidden in heaven and are nourished while still here on earth with the bread that comes from on high, we humbly entreat you, O Lord, that what is being brought about in us in mystery may come to true completion through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Bow your heads for God's special blessing.
O Lord, direct, we pray, the hearts of your faithful, and in your kindness, grant your servants this grace, that abiding in love of you and of their neighbor, they may fulfill the whole of your commandments through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May the blessing of Almighty God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit come upon us all and stay with us forever.
Amen.
Amen.
Go and announce the gospel of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We are sent forth singing number 692, I Heard the Voice of Jesus, number 692.